Now let's go to Gillian Lantouris, who's in Maribyrnong in Melbourne, where people are dealing with that aftermath. Jill, residents there now counting the cost of the damage to their homes.
Absolutely, Jane. With around 250 homes inundated by flood water, the cost is expected to reach the hundreds of millions. And joining me now is one of those residents, Nadia Fink. Thank you so much for your time. Nadia, talk me through the last 48 hours and Friday morning in particular.
Basically at 5:30 we had a knock on the door and there was SES in the front of the door. They said, get out, you have 15 minutes, otherwise the water's rising quickly. You just need to get out, get the essentials and just get out as fast as you can.
That's terrifying. How are you feeling?
I'm actually it's still really hard. Like, I've never experienced anything like it. There is a million things going through your head, but in the end, you just feel so numb. I was just running around the apartment, trying to grab all the pet supplies and just throwing random things onto the couch and the bed and just, Your brain, at least my brain, doesn't function in this. It's just, It was 5:30. They woke me up. It was a bit surreal, to be honest.
And you lived just over there. Your house was relatively okay in the end. You did stay in a hotel overnight. What are you doing today? I've seen you already walk around the streets trying to knock on neighbours' doors. What's your plan for the morning?
Basically, as we were really blessed that we didn't get flooded as much, it's pretty much just helping neighbours who weren't as lucky and, help them to get back to their homes as fast as we possibly can. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for your time, Nadia. I appreciate it. And as you can see, the cleanup is well underway behind me. There are some excavators and some street cleaners. One of them appears to be stuck in a bit of mud. So as you can see, it's very dangerous here. There's a lot of debris. The water has subsided, but as I said, it is very dangerous here. And anyone who doesn't have to be in this area is warned to stay away. Jane?
Thanks, Jill. Now let's bring in the Emergency Management Commissioner, Andrew Crisp, from the State Control Centre. Good morning to you, Commissioner. Thank you again for your time this morning. Can you bring us up to date from your end? What are the areas right now that are of most concern?
For us, it's really the north of the state. So it's Charlton, which has still got an evacuate now notice on it. Its peak keeps moving back. That looks like being later today. If I then move across Echuca, it's got evacuate now notice on it also. So encouraging people, please heed those warnings and get out of there. Yeah. Then as I move across to Shepparton and Maroopna, Kiala West, so it's too late to leave there now. The roads are closed and we know that we will see the peak of the Goulburn in that area in the early hours of tomorrow morning. But we're already seeing water rises in Maroopna and Shepparton, and there's already been a number of flood rescues there.
We were just crossing to our reporter who's in Echuca, Isabella Sashkovsky. She was inside a home there. The water is already, she said, a foot deep inside the home and it's still rising. What can people in places like that expect? How high do you think this thing could go?
Echuca, it's a dynamic situation. So we will see the water continue to rise there. So it will peak sort of overnight or later today, overnight. But it'll have a second peak when the water from the Goulburn, the Murray's already high. So we'll have one peak in the sort of next 24, 48 hours. And then in a few days' time, more water will come down towards Echuca. The bottom line is, download that Vic Emergency app, know who the emergency broadcaster is. You need to know how to access good information to make good decisions. This will continue to change and people need to stay across that information.
We also heard from another reporter that there has been some fluidity in the warnings, that there have been points through the night where people were told evacuate now and other points where they're told it's too late to leave. When those evacuation windows come out, how important is it that people take them?
Yeah, that did happen for Shepparton and Maroopna overnight, and that's why people need to stay across that information. We're continually assessing, and if we see there is an opportunity because things have slowed a little bit, we encourage people to heed those warnings. You've just got to look at Rochester, where some people didn't heed the warning, and we finished up with more than 160 rescues.
Do you have any idea on the numbers of people who've been told to evacuate so far and how many more could be told to leave home in the coming days?
Well, I think if you look at Shepparton and Maroopna, you know, you're talking 60,000 people. At Echuca, I think it's about 13,000 people. So it's literally thousands of people across, you know, a vast area the north of the state.
We know there is still so much water flowing through these towns. You're talking there about possible second peaks in some places. Can you put this in some kind of scale for us? How big is this thing and how worried are you?
Look, I'm not worried. I'm very confident if people do what we ask them to do. We've got great emergency services and so many people working on this. But this is a campaign. We've got weeks of this. All this water is flowing into the Murray and it will continue to work its way along the Murray. And we've got another weather system coming through next week. So we've got to stay focused and prepare as best we can.
Well, I'm sure everybody in those affected towns really appreciates the work that you and your staff are doing. Thank you for your time this morning, Commissioner. Now, as we heard, three states could be put on flood watch in the coming days with a low-pressure system forecast to sweep across the east coast. The system is expected to come up from South Australia from Tuesday. Falls of up to 25 mils could hit the central west of Queensland, far west of New South Wales and northern parts of Victoria by Thursday.
Welcome to Weekend Today on this Sunday morning.
Yeah, we've got a big show, but let's get straight to our top story, Victoria's flood crisis. Good morning, Jane.
Good morning to you, Belinda, and good morning to you at home. Yes, emergency crews are right now focused on the towns of Shepparton, Maroopna and Orvale, where waters are rising. Residents in those places have been told it is now too late to leave, and it comes as the flood crisis has claimed a life. A 71-year-old man found dead in floodwaters at Rochester. Local residents and business owners left to wade through the devastation.
Tight-knit community that has only really, especially for the business side of things as well, has only sort of just got over COVID and started opening doors again, started having functions and just another kick in the guts, I suppose.
Yeah, and in Melbourne, the major clean-up continues with the damage bill set to hit the hundreds of millions. Let's bring in our team of reporters now who are right across the flood zones. First, to Penelope Leish, who's in Shepparton. Good morning to you, Penny. The community there is banding together.
They are, Jane. I want to show you Wyndham Street, the Goulburn Valley Highway that runs through the middle of Shepparton. Have a look here. We've got cars halfway underwater in a parking lot here. Over here, we've got a road closed and then the tennis courts. They're pretty much a sea at the moment. And as we move around Victoria Park, through past this playground completely underwater, that's where the Victoria Lake usually is. There's a gym over at the back there. This is all completely covered in water. And it's not just coming from the rivers. It's also coming up through the drains here, which is starting to inundate big parts of the town. Now, Shepparton, Kyalla West, Maroopna, Murchison and Orvale, they are all under evacuation orders as being too late to leave. But we are seeing those orders continue to change. People need to keep a very close eye on those. There has been windows through the night where they've been changed to being evacuate orders to try and get people out to higher ground. Now, if you have a look at some of these preparations that we've been seeing around the town, dozens of people at Shepparton Showgrounds using everything they can, from shovels, sand hoppers, bobcats, to fill up thousands of sandbags, and people themselves then also filling up them at their own properties, putting them through backyards, up against houses as well, doing the best they can to prepare. We've just been speaking to Shepparton Search and Rescue a few minutes ago. They say they have been doing rescues overnight. They're about to get more boats out this morning. There are a lot of communities cut off here, a lot of roads cut off, so people really being urged to look at those warnings and to make sure they follow the advice of emergency services.
Thanks, Penny. Now let's go to Isabella Staszkowski, who's in Echuca this morning. And Izzy, you're inside a home that's been inundated there.
Jane, I am. Good morning. The owner of this property just came up to us on the street and said, please go inside my home so we can show people what it looks like here in Echuca. You can see I'm standing in about a foot of water. They woke to this at about 3 a.m. The water started going through the garage. They had a little bit of time so they could put some of these items up on higher ground. We're going to walk through. My cameraman Ben's just going to show you what it looks like here. They really didn't have that much time to prepare. There are still things floating. If we walk through into the kitchen now, they're appliances here are just on milk crates. They've just had enough time to put these items slightly on higher ground. But this is the situation really all throughout Echuca this morning. We've seen a number of homes like this. People on the streets are really overwhelmed. They're thinking about 2011. They're really worried about what's to come. We'll take you into this room here, and if we spin the camera around, you can see some of these items here, how the water is lapping up. You can see outside as well how that water level is pretty much the same as it is outside. It's gone throughout these sandbag barriers. As I say, many homes in this area will be looking like this morning. It is just devastating. This is the flooding that's coming from the Campaspe River. That is the waterway in Rochester that has really wiped that town off the map. We were there yesterday touring the town on a boat. It is just devastating in those areas. That's only about 20 minutes away. And right now, Jane, the ADF is coming in to help Echuca. They are trying to do what they can to try and save this town, because the fear is that the flooding here is going to get so much worse. We're now walking through, wading through. We can feel the carpet under us. Feet, and as I say, so many homes are going to be looking like this throughout the morning.
Oh, Isa, we just feel for all of them, and as heartbreaking it is to see that now, we know what it's going to be like when the water recedes and what they will have to deal with when that comes. So thank you for that report.
Well, Victoria's flood crisis is continuing this morning with several regional towns and cities under threat. Shepparton is one of those, and we're joined now by Shepparton Mayor Shane Sally. Thank you for coming on the program, Shane. And good morning to you. For many residents, it's now too late to leave. How is everybody coping?
Good morning, Richard. Thanks for having me on. Yeah, look, it's obviously mixed emotions. A lot of water came through last night and has obviously impacted a significant amount of properties across our region. So, you know, community spirit in some ways is up in regards to supporting each other to get through this. But then on the other side, there's a number of properties, almost 8,000, that have been impacted by the flood.
It's just relentless and overwhelming, isn't it? A massive sandbagging operation underway. People attempting to waterproof homes and businesses. I do imagine, as you said, that everyone is really rallying together.
Yeah, it's been great. I mean, the response has been fantastic to support those in need. As you mentioned, the sandbags, that'll be ongoing today as well at our two sites across Shepparton and Maroopna, which have been heavily impacted. We've got the ADF, SES, multiple volunteers, other key services that are all supporting each other. Not one organisation can do this. It's a huge community effort, and everyone's coming together at this particular point, which is great to see.
Yeah, and hats off to all those volunteers. Just incredible. Look, an evacuation centre was set up at the McIntosh Centre last night. How many people are currently there, Shane?
Yeah, so we've got two set up, one in here in Shepparton at the McIntosh Centre and one at the Ballantyne Centre in Tatura. So we've got 162 people currently at the Shepparton one, and that was as of 6 a.m. This morning, and about 120 at the Tatura one. But we obviously expect that to increase over the course of the next couple of days.
Yeah, a community of up to 50, 60,000 people and up to 4,000 homes that we're told were set to be affected by the floods. Is that still the case, round about the number?
Yeah, well, we're almost at 8,000 properties will be impacted by some sort of flood. Not obviously at the extreme level, the whole lot of them, but we're talking about major connection points to key points of our community. So, you know, just because your household might not be necessarily flooded, the reality is you may not be able to get to it or from it as well. So we understand that once the river peaks at some point tomorrow, then we automatically go into a recovery process and start supporting those that require that assistance.
Yeah. So with the peak of the Goulburn River still to come, how bad are you expecting this to potentially be?
Yeah, look, there's still that element of unknown. I mean, it's obviously exceeded some expectations. It's currently sitting at about 11.84 metres with an expected peak of 12.2 tomorrow. But, you know, these things change. There is some rain potentially upon us later in the week. What impact that has, we're not 100% sure. But the most important thing is for the community to be aware that there is so much work going on behind the scenes to ensure that the support levels are there now and obviously post the peak as well.
Well, our thoughts are certainly with you and your community, Shane. Thank you once again for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me on.
Back now with more on Victoria's flood crisis as many brace for what's to come. For others, the clean-up has already begun.
Yeah, for Rochester, north of Melbourne, the small town resembles an inland sea, isolated and inundated with a whole lot of water. Let's bring in Rochester resident Darcy Craig. Darcy, a very tight-knit community there, and we are so sorry for your loss. How are you doing, mate?
Yeah, morning, guys. Yeah, it is devastating, and as you said, tight-knit community that has only really, especially for the business side of things as well, has only sort of just got over COVID and started opening doors again, started having functions, and just another kick in the guts, I suppose, to get back on their feet.
Yeah, I can hear you there sloshing around in the water. What has the last 48 hours been like for you?
It's been a bit of a waiting game. The shock was really yesterday, knowing that it peaked overnight at, I think it was 3 a.m. And then I've just sort of come out this morning and had a bit of a look, and it's down to below ankle height, which is good.
So you're staying at a pub right now. Do you just want to turn the camera around and show us what it looks like?
Yes, it's crazy.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
Oh, man, look at that. Hey, Darcy, you've got 4 units in Rochester. They were damaged by the floods, of course. Were you hopeful that they might just be spared?
I was, Rich. They were about 450 mil or so off the ground, so there was 3 steps to get up to them. I was on 1 straight back from the river. And, when I went yesterday on the tinny and had a look, that was when I just missed it by 100 mil of water through them. So, you can see they're shame worn.
Wanting to the rescue.
It's peaked now, but obviously, the water's receding. But the big cleanup now begins, Darcy. How is the community of Rochester holding up?
That's one of the things. They are a real resilient community here, and I was just talking to the guy yesterday from Mitre 10, and he was saying that they're going to help out a heap with getting people back on their feet, and I think really the more hands, the better. What's going to get it done and get it done the quickest, especially for businesses to be able to open again and trade again. So, although it is a tight-knit town, the more hands the better to help the clean up, that's for sure.
Well, I'm sure the community is bonding together, and we just pray that you get all the help that you need, and mental help and physical help and all the support from around the country. Thank you for sharing those pictures with us today and your story, Darcy. We wish you well, mate. All the best.
Yeah, thanks, Darcy.
Bye.